Can you spread some cheer? Do you think from your vantage point, the series of cuts, and one will come on October 4th, I assume, is enough to turn the demand for loans?
Well, I mean, you are all aware that the economic indicators started going kind of in the negative territory from sometime later, latter half of last year. And kind of it has gradually spread across various sectors of the economy. The government has done a lot since August. I think a series of announcements week after week after week, in spite of the fact that the hands were tied behind the back. So congratulations to the government for doing all this. So yes, we are seeing some signs of at least the positive sentiment return. For example, as far as auto loans is concerned, you know, we are seeing our applications are 15 to 20% month on month. We are seeing something similar on the mortgage side. Today, I think papers talk about how the e-commerce sites are talking about pickup in the demand in terms of at least when they are doing the $1 billion days, they have seen the traffic go up, the orders go up, especially from the tier two, tier three towns as they talked about. And I think the slew of, you know, if when you went and asked people why is this economic indicators looking negative, I think people did not have any one reason. There were a series of reasons which were advanced, and I think all of it kind of boiled down to the sentiment, that the sentiment seems negative. I think what government has done is brought in these slew of measures and hopefully turn the sentiment a little bit more positive. I think obviously next 3-4 weeks will be crucial because the festive season is on, and if these 3 to 4 weeks can demonstrate a positive momentum, I think it will definitely start turning the ship around. It is a big ship. It is not going to happen overnight. It will take time. But I think the government's intent is there. I think banks and everyone is willing to support. There is enough liquidity in the system. So the issue is not that the money is lacking. The issue is can we find the right people who want to consume, and can we find those right people with the right kind of, you know, financial risk profile to give them the money?
Oh, absolutely. Mr. Chaudhury, good morning. First of all, thank you for being here with us in our new studio. You know, I wanted to ask you, you spoke about auto loans and how things are improving. In the last fortnight, the big talking point was what's happening with real estate lenders. You know, you saw the sudden blow up with Altico, with PMC, etc. You think the worst is not over in that space?
Well, in India, the worst does not get over overnight. In India, the worst takes time because, as you could make out, the PMC problem, it appears, again, based on what you read in the newspaper articles, today morning says has been going on since 2008, if I remember correctly. So, you know, this bad news tends to trickle, and because the bad news keeps coming in spurts and through a pretty long period of time, it takes time for some of this crisis to blow over. I think PMC, I'm sure, is a surprise. Altico, based on, again, what you read in the newspapers, it appears that they started facing problem a couple of months back. There are quite a few NBFCs out there who have asset liability mismatch issue. There are quite a few NBFCs where the market suspects the quality of their asset book. And while the NBFCs have been quite vocal and transparent about how their asset liability situation is, I think a lot of NBFCs have not really come out in terms of sharing and being more transparent about what the quality of their asset book is. And there are question marks around that. There is a risk attached to disclosing too much about your asset book, because sometimes when you're too transparent, things can blow up in your face quickly. So you have to manage that problem. So I don't think this problem is going to go away. There is no magic bullet. Frankly, I don't see any reason why government should exercise a magic bullet. It will take time. The pain will go to the NBFCs, to the lenders of those NBFCs, and it will take time to manage itself through. The governor has, I think, said repeatedly that they're monitoring 50 large NBFCs and HFCs, and they will try to ensure that none of them kind of blows up. Let's see, whatever period of time will happen. But I don't think an NBFC crisis is going to cause further problems in terms of systemic issues. I think some of the big ones have happened. So I think, yes, bad news might continue to come, and I think the bad news can be managed. I think, yes, some of the people will suffer in the process, but I don't expect a big one to happen. I don't expect. But, because the government is so clear about what they want to do. And, they're trying to solve the problem in different ways. If you look at what they have done with, talking about a 20,000 crore corpus to ensure that the last mile projects are completed. That will also reflect positively on the NBFC's balance sheet, because a lot of the stress in the NBFC's is related to some of that stuff. So if they can ensure that the last mile real estate projects are completed, NBFC's will lend to those projects will also start seeing some flow of money. Yes, maybe a lot of these NBFC's cannot lend for. Maybe they have to kind of slow or stop where they are, but hopefully they'll be able to survive.
Amitabh, in our celebration, we forgot to congratulate you. 18,500 crore is quite a haul.
12.5 I wish capital. We could put, but it is 12,500 crores. Yes. Okay. Yes.
I think that was the demand you got.
We went to the market with 10 plus 2.5. We were able to raise 13. I mean, we got demand for 13,300 crores. I think it was a gutsy move in the environment which we did it. I have to thank the finance minister for the next day when we're going to close the issue to
absolutely
the
you lucky.
That we got a bit lucky, but we had obviously closed the issue by then. But we thought that given the economic environment and what is happening, it is important to have gunpowder in place. If you look at the large banks, our capital ratio was on the lower side. It was important that we kind of raise the bar a little bit. Also have, capital for our growth capital for the future. And, having it behind us, it is very, very important. We can focus on, executing what we talked about through our GPS strategy. And that's all the management team also focus on, rather than having this constant requests from investors or advice from various people saying that you should be raising capital soon. So that is out of the way.
And so is such an advice, of course. Can you give us some color on the quality of investors?
So we had mainly long-term, long-only investors. As I said, we had a demand of 13,300 crores. Obviously, the investors, because of the largesse of the government, have done very, very well. They have made quite a bit of money in a very short period of time. Actually, they made the money without even putting in the money because the money came to us only on Wednesday. But yes, we are happy that investors have made money. It led to close to 7.5% dilution. And our capital now we expect to be close to 14% CET1 ratio, which puts us very much in the same zone as some of the best banks.
Okay.
And it just allows us, so from our perspective, our capital position is strong, our management team is in place, most of our asset issues are behind us.
Okay.
On a competition, as far as competition is concerned, we are well placed. We are looking forward to the good times to come, hopefully.
Okay, so life is good basically at the moment.
With the capital raise, we can smile more, but yes, we have, we talked about a 3-year strategy, a lot to execute on, a lot of work to be done.
On that, there was a bit of heartache for investors when the slippages in the previous quarter came in at, I think, a 4-quarter high or something. So, from a best in class bank, you sometimes worry about whether that's a sign of what's happening with the economy as well. You think, what could the trajectory of slippages be as we head into the next few quarters?
Well, we keep talking about what is happening on our stress book on a pretty transparent and regular basis, which we'll do that again and on October, third week. Our BB and below book is the stock of the stress book from our perspective, at least on the wholesale side. Yes, in the first quarter, we had more slippages than we expected. It is a combination of 2-3 factors. One is that we are just trying to be a more conservative bank.
Mm-hmm.
And in that process, it is very, very important for us to take things down when we believe things are not looking okay. And that's what we did. Maybe the investors are not expecting it, but we wanted to be transparent, and we will keep doing it. We're not going to shy away from it.
Mm-hmm.
Second, yes, there were some assets which have been in the BB and below book for a long period of time. And in many cases, given what has been happening on NCLT and the pressure from various regulatory agencies and the economic situation in the country, some of these assets did slip. So this is the stock of the passbook, and we are still obviously managing that passbook. It will take some time to manage this book as we go forward. So kind of these three factors contributed to it. Yes, the market did beat us up for what they thought was a slightly larger slippage than what they expected. I think we just have to focus on keep executing, ensuring that this cautious, deliberate, and conservative approach we have talked about in our sustainability part of our strategy, we keep working on that. And once we can give the confidence to investors that we have our arms around the sustainability problem which Axis Bank has had, I think they will reward us differently.
Okay. Yeah. Well, you have capital now. And you have an insurance relationship. Everyone knows that at the moment the fund is not in distributing as much as in manufacturing insurance. What are the options on the table?
So firstly, we have had a lot of fun distributing. It's not that we did not have fun. But yes, we have had a long, I think you're referring to life insurance. We have had a long, deep and very satisfactory relationship with Max.
Yes.
And I do want to emphasize that. Our biggest concern and constraint is that we need for regulatory forbearance. And RBI has been quite clear in terms of what kind of equity stake they will allow us. So that's the biggest hurdle to cross. Yes, ideally we would like to get into manufacturing if the regulator permits us, but obviously they have to give us the green signal.
But you have a circuitous route, I was told by some lawyers, that you can become a holding company.
They are lawyers, they are investment bankers, they're investors, so there is no shortage of them. but end of the day, it is the regulator who has to give the green signal. Just a lawyer saying yes is not going to work for us. So we have been talking to our potential partners on a regular basis. Obviously, Max, given our relationship, is an obvious choice. whenever we are ready to announce something, if we have some structure which works, we will be the first ones to tell you. But in the meanwhile, we are also very focused on our distribution side because it is an important part of our fee income. And we want to ensure that across the insurance space, plus the mutual funds, etc., we continue to build our franchise and continue to use our distribution power.
But this structure of putting up a non-operative holding company and Axis Bank being a subsidiary and whatever insurance JV being a subsidiary is not feasible, it's not tax efficient?
No, so the government has to create the right framework for us.
The laws don't exist, you mean?
The laws, I mean, if you have to create a non-operating financial holding company, change the shareholding from one entity to the other, there are tax issues involved, there is an issue on what does the RBI want, which entity does the RBI want to be listed. I think some of those issues have to be clarified. It is not an easy question to answer. It's not that RBI is quite clear in terms of what they want to do, but I think there are some difficult questions to answer, and they have to work with the government to ensure that those questions are answered in the right way. So it is taking time. And in the process, we are potentially maybe losing out an opportunity to make money for our shareholders, but it's okay. I mean, I think everyone knows what they're doing. So
Okay, I just want to point out once to our viewers that the two stocks that are falling a lot right now are RBL Bank and IndusInd Bank. Remember, both these banks have an exposure to the India Bulls Group. They fell quite a bit on Friday as well after the news flow came out about the SEBI announcement. So, IndusInd Bank, look at that, another 5% lower, and RBL Bank as well is now down almost 6.5%. Mr. Chaudhury, you started by telling us there's a bit of an improvement as far as loan growth is concerned in autos, etc. But amongst the three segments that you cater to, corporate loans, retail loans and SME, where do you see the maximum potential now and what kind of growth rates are we looking at?
So, obviously, if you look at our numbers over the last 5 years, our retail growth has been higher than corporate side, because on the corporate side we've been very focused on solving our NPL problem. So today retail accounts for more than 53% of our overall loan book. SME is another 13 and balance is corporate. We see huge opportunities in retail because we are coming from behind. We are not the largest player in the marketplace. We have just introduced our two-wheeler loans. Talk about timing. Mm-hmm. We have just launched our two-wheeler loan category, and I'm sure the manufacturers are quite happy that another large lender is coming and working with them during these times. But yes, we see a lot of opportunity in the SME space also. Yes, the market is tough. MSME sector tends to suffer the most because the leverage with the large buyers of theirs is the least. And also with the government and even announcing that they'll give them some leeway in terms of repayments, they tend to kind of step back a little bit. So yes, we are seeing some slippages on the SME side, though the net slippage ratio remains very much under control. So they are delaying the payments, but they are obviously paying you over a period of time. Okay. I do see SME sector broadly defined as a huge growth opportunity because there is a large part of that sector which is still not financed by banks. And I think we can find ways and means of financing that. I think that can be a great growth opportunity for a bank like us, who has been a very large player in the SME sector for the longest period of time. So we understand that space. I think some enablers have to be put in place. We also need to ensure that we can get our systems and technology right, which we're working on. So both retail and SME remain solid in terms of growth opportunity. And then, well, finally, the corporate side, we have kind of slowed down quite a bit over the last couple of years. We need to get our rightful place back on the corporate side too. And we are working towards it. Yes, I think we have a kind of base effect continue to kick in, but you will see growth coming in the corporate side also.
That was going to be my question, actually. Now, many of the corporates, manufacturing guys, have a manna from heaven. The Marutis, the Bajaj, they all spoke to us and said that they will invest in technology. Any chatter? Has anyone already approached? You have approached anyone? Do you see the capex cycle?
Nothing too early to say right now. But I do believe, given the kind of tax breaks which the government has given, I don't see any reason why the manufacturing side will not pick up. But, these decisions take time. They have to first come up with a plan. Then they have to decide, where to put up the plant. They have to get all the permissions in place and then, arrange the money and then actually start investing. So it will take time. It will not happen in a hurry. But yes, I think now from a tax perspective, we are well placed across a lot of economies around the world. And from a place of doing business perspective, our rankings will continue to move up. So government is trying, it's not an easy journey, but it is trying to ensure that the right ecosystem is created for manufacturing to come back in India in a big way. But it will take a couple of quarters for it to start having an impact.
But nevertheless, a last question, why don't you leave us with a loan growth guidance?
Oh, well, we have been quite actually clear about that. We have said that we will continue to grow, and we believe we can grow at 5 to 6% more than whatever the industry growth rate is. So if the industry growth rate moves up, well, we believe we can continue to keep that gap between us and the industry growth rate. We have talked about three things. We have said we aspirationally we want to deliver 18% ROE, aspirationally. We have talked about getting our expense to asset ratio down to below 2%, and also getting our credit costs down to below 1%. And that has been one of the key kind of matrices in our GPS strategy, and we are sticking to it. We are not
shying
away.
And that should be in by FY21?
22, yes.
Okay.